Friends, we have heard from High Commissioner of Australia to India, Ambassador Barry O'Farrell, and High Commissioner of India to Australia, Ambassador Geetesh Sharma, about the significance of the meeting between the two Prime Ministers, Prime Minister Modi and Prime Minister Morrison. To throw more light on the significance of this meeting and also the importance of this relationship, let me now turn to a few experts present in the audience. Let me first talk to Ambassador Anil Wadhwa. Ambassador Wadhwa has served as India's ambassador to many countries, including Italy, Thailand, and Oman. Recently, Government of India has tasked him with the responsibility of preparing an Australia Economic Strategy Report. Ambassador Wadhwa would be the right person to tell us more about what are his recommendations to the government through the report, and also the significance of the outcomes of Prime Minister Morrison and Prime Minister Modi's meeting. Ambassador Wadhwa, may I ask you to please give us your views and also some details about the strategy paper that you are presenting to Government of India.
So let me begin by saying that although the Indo-Australian relationship has seen some very rocky times, but in the recent past, in fact I would say over the past decade in particular, we've seen that this relationship has blossomed all around, and this is driven by multiple factors, first and foremost geopolitics, but also the need which has been felt by Australia to step up its economic relationship with India, and the growing Indian diaspora in Australia, which is now close to 700,000. The Australian government and the Prime Minister Scott Morrison accepted and adapted an India Economic Strategy to 2035 report, and that happened in November 2018 during the visit of our President Ramnath Kovind to Australia. The Australian government is now, as we speak, taking necessary measures to implement the recommendations in this report to increase Australian investments from the current 10 billion Australian dollars to 100 billion Australian dollars by 2035, and also to focus on intensive engagement in 10 specific areas. Now, these 10 specific areas include things like education, tourism, resources, and agribusiness. And that's concentrated on 10 states. 10 states of focus in India. Prime Minister Modi, during a meeting with Prime Minister Scott Morrison on the sidelines of the East Asia Summit, and that happened in November 2018, he conveyed that India will reciprocate with a similar Australia-focused report. From the Indian perspective. So it is this report which I have been working on along with CII and KPMG team over the past many months. And this report has been prepared, as I told you, in a response to Australia's Economic Strategy Report 2035, and is now awaiting final approvals. Hopefully this will be taken forward through another virtual event in the future when officials and industry from both sides could participate and look at the concrete recommendations in 20 different areas which have been identified. So the Australia Economic Strategy Report has identified opportunities across a very broad range of sectors, and that includes mining, technology and resources, data analytics and cloud computing, information technology and financial services, agribusiness, healthcare and pharmaceuticals, education and skills development, railways and automobile components, startups, renewable energy, medical technologies and devices and infrastructure. But there are also, by the way, some niche and futuristic areas of opportunity, and that includes ferries and shipbuilding, medical and water technologies, textile and textile designing, digital gaming, tourism, labor-intensive services, education technologies, and space and defense, which have relevance in the future aspirations of both countries. So, unlike the Australian report, the Indian report does not limit itself to a time frame. It does not also focus on any particular states, but rather only dwells on specific opportunities with case studies. So if businesses and governments put their efforts together, I believe that India has the potential to increase its exports in goods and services to Australia from the $5 billion that we did in 2018 to $15 billion in 2025 and also $35 billion in 2035. Most of the MOUs, which were signed during the Modi Morrison virtual summit, which happened on 4th of June, are in line with these recommendations. And I'd like to mention a few examples here. First, let's look at the implementing arrangement concerning cooperation in defense science and technology, which is an arrangement to the MOU on defense cooperation, which already exists. So this provides a framework for growing collaboration between technology research organizations of both countries. The areas already identified in the report, in the draft report from our side for such collaboration include advanced sensors, underwater technologies, quantum computing and cryptography, laser techniques, hypersonic technologies and technology cooperation in shipbuilding between Indian shipyards and Australian shipbuilding industries. Second, Prime Minister Modi also conveyed that India is working on its Mars and Moon missions and Australia can work with India in collaboration. So here, space situational activities, calibration and validation of satellite data, sharing of meteorology and oceanographic data, and also establishment of ground station in Australia, these are already identified areas of collaboration and we have that in our report as well. Third, Australia has reserves of 21 out of 49 minerals identified by India's critical minerals strategy. Many rare earths are required in manufacturing processes of electric motors, lithium batteries, magnets and other end-use products for India's e-mobility program. So the MOU on cooperation in the field of mining and processing of critical and strategic minerals will ensure a long-standing supply and investment relationship between the two countries in the area of critical minerals. It will also ensure that the two countries collaborate on new technologies for exploration and for extraction of minerals. Fourth point that I'd like to mention is that India's large and young population and the target that we have of 400 million people to be trained by 2022 has actually thrown open a host of opportunities for the Australian vocational education system. And the MOU on vocational education and training will extend the collaboration between Indian and Australian agencies across enhancement of training curriculum, aligning Indian accreditation and assessment into global standards, improving trainer quality, and also conducting joint training workshops. Fifth issue that I'd like to mention is the a new collaborative arrangement on water resources management, training and education, and for developing sustainable solutions for water and economic development and water recycling. And that is also in line with the recommendations that we have in the draft report. Sixth, the Australia-India Scientific Reserve Fund. That is an example of successful research fund which has been set up between the two countries back in 2004, in fact, which has seen joint funding for a number of successful projects And these are in the areas of life sciences, biotechnology, genetics, etc. So the COVID-19 pandemic has highlighted the need for both countries now to strengthen their research and development exchanges and to provide support for the health sector in both countries. So they've both sides have agreed through the joint statement to have a one-off COVID-19 collaboration round based on the Scientific Reserve Fund in 2020. And the draft report again recommends enhancement of the fund. It also proposes setting up of a similar fund in the field of humanities and another fund in the field of startups. Seventh, the flagging of the need to strengthen India-Australia partnership on grains management and logistics to reduce post-harvest losses, rationalize costs and supply chain logistics, and setting up educational campuses in each other's countries during the summit are also proposals which are there in the draft report. Finally, I would say regardless of India's stand on the RCEP, the report recommends, and the summit has endorsed this, that India and Australia should now restart their free trade agreement negotiations, which were stalled due to RCEP. There's a lot to gain if this comes about quickly for both countries. Australia is an ideal strategic partner for India as we move towards achieving adequately high growth for our large and growing population, and also for meeting our challenges of rapid urbanization, for infrastructure development and water resources. And Australian natural resources, technology and high-end manufacturing also requires a market like India. So I firmly believe that the time has come for a very strong, reliable and multifaceted relationship between India and Australia.
We also have with us Ambassador Navdeep Suri. Ambassador Suri has worked as India's ambassador to many countries and retired from UAE last year. Ambassador Suri has served as India's High Commissioner to Australia between 2015 and 2016. I now turn to Ambassador Suri. Ambassador Suri, you have served in Australia as India's High Commissioner. When you were the High Commissioner, China and Australia had close trade and economic ties. In the last decade or so, the two countries have become strong partners in trade and economy. So much so that today, Australia's economic partnership with China is many times bigger than Australia's economic partnership with India. In that scenario, the growing Australia-India ties, how are they going to impact the geopolitics in the region? How will China look at this growing bonhomie between these two countries? What will be the implications for geopolitics in the region of our two countries coming together? I request you to give your views on the geopolitical fallout of Australia-India relations. Ambassador Suri.
Thank you very much, Ramadhaji. You're absolutely right that right through the 1980s, 90s, and the first decade of the 2000s, and even the second decade, the Australian-Chinese relationship, the economic relationship, and even to an extent the political relationship, grew very, very rapidly. For Australia, China is the largest trading partner, and if you look at it to get a sense of perspective, India is the fifth largest. And I think the trade with China is larger than the next five partners put together. Australia, China has been a critical economic partner because, as you mentioned in your remarks, and Ambassador Madhwa mentioned, Australia is exceptionally well endowed when it comes to all kinds of minerals. A lot of the Chinese industrial boom was fueled by coal and copper and iron ore and other minerals from Australia. And the Australians would take pride that, look, while other OECD countries were going through various bouts of recession through the 90s and the 2000s, Australia kind of remained recession-proof because of its close relationship. But while this really large, dynamic, synergetic relationship was developing on the economic side, there was also a creeping recognition that Australia was perhaps giving up or being oblivious to some of the more insidious elements that were creeping in on the political side. There were several specific examples to which people were trying to draw attention. On the political side, there were efforts to bribe politicians, to bribe political parties, to sort of buy influence wherever you could. There was an active approach by China to expand its influence on university campuses by using Chinese students, by using the 12 Confucius Institutes that they've established across the campuses, by even trying to fund research projects in sensitive areas which would have defense implications later on. We saw also, along with that, that there was examples of cybersecurity violations, of hacking of the Australian Parliament, of hacking of the Australian National University in Canberra, which was again linked to Chinese state actors. We saw the manner in which Chinese state-owned entities, including some linked with the PLA, the People's Liberation Army, went after strategic assets, the Darwin port, strategic not only for the Australians, but also for the Americans, for the marine sort of facilities that they have used it for, is a case in point. And it was leased to a Chinese entity for 99 years. There was an attempt to buy Ausgrid, which is the main power utility in New South Wales, and which also provides critical infrastructure for fiber optics and for defense-related applications. So all of this was happening, and suddenly, I think the Australians, who until now were fairly happy with the economic side, and the business lobby would always dominate the security agencies who were trying to point the attention towards some of these things that were going on, there was a recognition that things had gotten out of hand. And so 2015 onwards, the Australians really started taking defensive measures to protect their open economy, to by strengthening the Foreign Investment Review Board, by strengthening the regulatory regime for critical infrastructure, by making sure that states in Australia couldn't sign away the rights on something like Darwin Port, for example, by tightening up the corruption or transparency proceedings processes for political parties. All of that administrative and legislative measures they had to take to defend their country from very organized intrusions by the Chinese. When you look at other countries in the region, and that's the geopolitical aspect, so the Australians, I think, are more than ready to embrace other like-minded countries. And so when I see the bilateral relationship, when I see the mutual logistics supply agreement or the defense science and technology and research agreement or the maritime domain awareness or some of the discussions around the Quad and the Quad Plus, there are lots of little bridges, even in critical infrastructure. You'd probably look closely and find China written in small print on those bridges. Lithium is a case in point, and Ambassador Vadva mentioned about it. But the richest lithium mines have already been taken by the Chinese in Australia, as an example. And the Australians are now keen to diversify and bring in others who would at least do some refining of that before taking away the ore itself. So my sense on the broader geopolitical picture is that the brazenness of Chinese actions over the last few years, and even now, while the world is facing a pandemic in Vietnam, in Indonesia, in Ladakh, of course, for us, are factors that will drive like-minded countries towards each other. The US would be more than happy to encourage it. The Australians, after having initially during Kevin Rudd's time messed up a little bit on the quad arrangement, have been pushing us on it very actively. And I think what I see as a big political takeaway from the virtual summit is the conscious effort to strengthen the institutional architecture for the relationship at the highest political levels. Whether it is the decision to have an annual summit one each year between the prime ministers, whether it is the elevation of the 2+2 dialogue, which was up till now between the foreign secretaries and defense secretaries of the two countries, to a ministerial level once in 2 years, or indeed the fact that we will now have mutual logistics support arrangements with all of the Quad members are examples. So I think that at least from my time in Australia and even subsequently, the Australians were extra keen to move forward with us. And we were always mindful of Chinese sensibilities. And we would all explain that, look, you guys have an ocean between you and China. We've got a 3,600 kilometer border, 3,500 kilometer border that we need to deal with. So we need to handle things differently. But given the aggressive approach that China is demonstrating, not just towards Australia and towards India, but others, I think this is a good time to for like-minded countries, for democracies to get together and look at their own interests. And if once in a while China feels slightly offended, so be it. I think what you see, and this is a key point because your question was, would the Australians be ready to go along with this? My question is, are we ready to go along with the overtures that the Australians have been making quite consistently? Because what they have shown through Prime Minister Scott Morrison's public statements is that they are willing to stand up to the bullying to which they've been subjected, the threats of economic coercion, the 80% tariffs on barley and beef, the decision, the announcement there by the Chinese to stop to warn tourists from going to Australia, a country which is almost pandemic-free now. So the Australians haven't taken kindly to the economic coercion threats, and I think it's a good time for countries like ours to come together.
Thank you, Ambassador Suri. That was very illuminating. Friends, India and Australia are maritime neighbors. We undertake joint naval exercises. We have defense cooperation between our two countries. And during the recent meeting between our two prime ministers, we have signed the Comprehensive Strategic Partnership Agreement and also the Mutual Logistics Support Agreement. It indicates growing maritime partnership between our two countries. To talk more about it, I would like to now invite Vice Admiral Shekhar Sinha. Vice Admiral Shekhar Sinha has served as the Commander-in-Chief of the Western Naval Command. As a senior Navy officer, he has had interactions with the Australian Navy. With his experience in the maritime domain, I would like to ask Admiral Shekhar Sinha about how this growing maritime partnership between India and Australia is going to impact India's Indo-Pacific strategy, whether it is going to help India deepen its Indo-Pacific strategy and activism, or it is also likely to lead to controversies, conflicts in the region. To talk more about it, I would like to now call upon Vice Admiral Shekhar Sinha. Admiral Shekhar Sinha, it's your turn.
Thank you, Ram Madhavji, for this opportunity. My sense is that this comprehensive strategic partnership has opened a plethora of opportunities as far as the maritime is concerned. And if you read through the entire document, you know, it is really a maritime domain driven agreement between the two countries. You know, there is a lot of convergence as far as the following the rule of the law is concerned, the value-based system, value of democracy, which it mentions very clearly, and other convergences, for example, the Indo-Pacific Vision Document of India and Australia's Pacific Step Up in South Pacific. So these two documents are going to be now seen very closely. Both countries share the same vision of open and free and rule-based Indo-Pacific region, supported by the inclusive global and regional institutions, which is essential for promoting stable, prosperous and sovereignty of states on the basis of shared interests, which you mentioned. Now here it differs a little bit from what the US has been saying in its Indo-Pacific strategy, where it willy-nilly says that, you know, the growth of China and China's assertiveness needs to be contained. But these two countries, Australia and India, are a little bit careful in that by saying that it is inclusive, and they don't wish to take any sort of offensive action against China. They want China to come into the fold of maritime security of the Indo-Pacific and not so much as the Americans were saying. So I see that there is a great convergence as far as the maritime power is concerned between these two countries, rather than being very, very close to what the Americans want to say. As regards the maritime cooperation for ensuring open and inclusive Indo-Pacific, both countries are of the view that the majority of future challenges will occur in the maritime sphere and in the Indo-Pacific. So I feel that the this joint document on the shared vision for maritime cooperation in the Indo-Pacific, the details of which are yet to emerge. And as both the ambassadors have pointed out, that two things are very, very, very essential. Having already done the white shipping agreement, which essentially means the movement of the merchant ships between the Indian Ocean and the Pacific, the intelligence was being shared. But now they are saying that the engagement will be deeper in the maritime domain awareness and the expanded linkages between the maritime agencies. So basically, the Austin, which you are doing right now, Australia-India bilateral exercises, the value and the intensity and complexity is going to increase now. It is quite possible that submarines and the maritime patrol aircraft will be brought into this, just like it is done in the Malabar. So once that happens at the level of these two countries, then you will find that possibly Australia will start off joining the Malabar. It may happen sooner than later, because I am of the view that these institutions must be put in place very, very quickly, because you heard the previous Prime Minister Kevin Rudd's opinion on this. He was slow. He was sort of always putting a little bit of stop on that. In fact, just the other day in an interview to some TV channel, he has again cautioned the government to go a little slow on this Quad and Quad Plus, given the sensitivities of China. But the reasons, of course, have been mentioned by members quite well, so I need not go on that. This also includes the preservation of the marine ecosystem, blue economy, seabed mining, joint exploration, and other emerging areas of sea marine research. So I think it's a very wide scope, and there is a plethora of sort of cooperation which is going to take place now. Now, the one important aspect which I see in this is that some of the existing bilaterals, which is between, let's say, India and another country, and Australia and another country, they are likely to become a little bit of multilateral or trilateral. For example, the Australia-Japan and India-Japan, it is going to become a trilateral, which is very important as far as the maritime security is concerned in Asian region, in the Indo-Pacific region, with ASEAN as the central theme of the entire thing. Similarly, the Australia, Indonesia, Australia, Vietnam, They have their bilaterals, and we have bilaterals as well. Once they become trilateral, then you will find that, as they say, you know, the Asia is for Asians, which the Chinese have been saying. So these three countries, or these three trilaterals, are actually going to make a system of ensuring security and other marine aspects. Even if the Americans, the U.S. Navy, begins to be more inward and less participative in this entire area of Indo-Pacific. Because if you look at it, U.S. is the biggest force at the moment, but the gradual withdrawal of the U.S. may lead to these middle powers, Japan, Australia, India, Indonesia, and possibly Vietnam and France. France has got a lot of interest. So these countries and navies have to come together. They will come together. And the rather than having your bases in many of these countries, your own bases, the logistic support arrangement makes sure that you can operate from their bases at the end of an exercise or at the end of an operation. And similarly, they can come and operate from your part once they are deployed in the Indian Ocean. So I see this as a great, great thing to happen, that we are looking at a system which is going to be a post-COVID architecture, if you like, world order, if you like, where US or China participating or not participating may not make much of a difference and still be credible, you know, the security system.
Thank you, Admiral Sinha. Are you then suggesting that India should give up its hesitance and invite Australia to become a partner in the Malabar exercises? Do you foresee that happening in the near future?
Yes, Ram Madhav, your understanding is quite correct. I will just refer to one meeting that we have had. The Australian National Defence College members had come to India, and Carnegie had done a little bit of interaction with them, with Professor Raja Mohan and myself being the two of Indian side. And there was a foreign service officer from Australia. I don't remember the year. I think it was 2015 or maybe 16. The Australian foreign service officer of the rank of joint secretary, he asked me the same question, that what is the apprehension? My impromptu reply was, is Australia keen to join? And there was a silence, and the joint secretary was doing the court, was quite surprised. So I looked at the JAG branch officer of the Australian Navy, who I knew, and I said, why don't you speak your mind? I think Mr. Kevin was the Prime Minister at that time. And she said in one line to the Foreign Service officer, this is not the right time for us to be joining. It will take a little bit of time, but someday we will join. So I'll just give you this input, that it was not so much our apprehension. Yes, our Navy was a little bit apprehensive because the Australian Navy sort of was on the bit of decline. Their submarine contract had been cancelled because of some input on the question of little bit of mismanagement of the finances there. But now those things are in place, and the French are going to make those submarines very similar to ours in Australia. So there is likely to be series production. So we will see the interaction now increasing, and the complexity of exercise increasing over a period of time and coming right up to the level of Malabar. Because Malabar has really gone to, India, US has gone to very high levels of complexity. You know, we have interoperability between PTI and the submarines that we have. And now that we will have French submarine, it will become even better. The Australian ships and Indian submarines have been able to talk. We have had methods of communication. So those things will have become a little more easier now that all these four countries who form the basis of the Quad, subsequently, you might find Malabar becoming the security architecture of Quad, which is not very visible at the moment. But my gut feeling is that it could probably become like this in a post-COVID world.
Thank you. Ambassador Suri, you have heard Admiral Shekhar Sinha suggesting that the Malabar exercises should eventually become the security architecture for the Quad. I wanted to ask you, what will be the geostrategic or geopolitical implications of such a decision by the partners in Quad or partners in the Malabar exercises? I would also like to ask another question. From the time of Kevin Rudd to Tony Abbott to Turnbull to Prime Minister Morrison today, you have seen Australia's close relationship with China and the pendulum moving towards India. Do you see bipartisan consensus in Australia over the growing relationship between the two countries, namely India and Australia? Or do you also anticipate China trying to pull any political strings in Australia? Ambassador Suri.
You know, I think that's a great question. And let me just say that I wouldn't dwell too much on Kevin Rudd. His relevance in Australian politics is marginal at best. And the antipathy with which even the Foreign Service that he belonged to sees him is quite something. You have to meet those people and hear it firsthand to get a sense of it. The key point is, we need to recognize the changes that have taken place in Australia post Kevin Rudd. You know, you had Malcolm Turnbull as after Tony Abbott. First, Tony Abbott was the first Australian Prime Minister to come to India after Prime Minister Modi's inauguration for the first term. And there was this great hope and anticipation that this relationship would be one of those defining things as we move forward. Abbott didn't last very long and Malcolm Turnbull came. And he, to his credit, and you know, initially when I was there, I was a little skeptical because, you know, okay, he's got a daughter-in-law who's from China and so on. So you kind of take those things into account. But he's the one who started taking actions against Chinese expansionism in Australia during his term as Prime Minister. And of course, he also visited India. And you saw the emergence of two elements. One is a bipartisan concern about China. And the second was a bipartisan interest in expanding the relationship with India. And again, this year itself in 2020, what's the position that Scott Morrison has taken against China, saying that we will defend our values and not trade those away, has received support from the leaders of opposition. Both Anthony Albanese and Penny Wong have come out strongly in support of that. And similarly, Scott Morrison came here with a message of support from the leaders of our opposition saying that this is a critical relationship. So I think we are in a remarkably sweet spot at this point of time. That allows me to revert to the first question that you had about how the expansion of the Malabar and the invitation potentially to the Australians would be perceived by others in the region. I really think that we shouldn't be too mindful of those sensibilities. You know, we have seen islands emerge in the ocean that were not there, in the sea that were not there. We have seen statements that those islands, once they emerged, which were not islands, would never be militarized, and then they were. Now we see statements about the legitimate right of the very same countries that built those islands that were never there in the first place to be defended as parts of the national territory, etc., etc. So given the egregious manner in which one player chooses not to play by the rules, I think gives enough latitude to others to establish their own rules of the game and play to our strengths rather than be overly mindful. And I think it also gets us additional leverage. We may be having weaknesses in certain areas, but we have our own strengths, and let's play to our strengths, which bring other countries together, whether it is on the basis of values or it is on the basis of a more transparent political and economic system.
Thank you, Ambassador Suri. Finally, I will again come back to Ambassador Wadhwa. Ambassador Wadhwa, you, in your initial comments, you have suggested that RCEP is an opportunity. Now we have lot of reticence with respect to a bilateral free trade agreement with Australia. I am myself privy to the long discussions that have taken place in last 5 years, but somehow there seems to be some disinterest or some apprehension with regard to having a free trade agreement. Similar apprehension, similar reticence you find with respect to RCEP also. So what do you think will be India's advantage if we really decide to tomorrow again open negotiations on RCEP? Also, do you think that pending the RCEP, a free trade agreement is a possibility between India and Australia? Is it going to form a part of your recommendations also? I thought I will ask you that as the final question of our discussion today.
Right. So let me begin with the second question first. I think the reason why it is important to reopen negotiations with Australia is because at the moment it doesn't seem likely that India is going to rejoin the RCEP negotiations. If and when it does, it'll be on certain conditions, and we all know that they are based on the apprehensions that India has on flooding of our markets by the Chinese in particular, and also the fact that it does not have a proper redressal mechanism. And of course, we have the baseline for the tariffs, which cannot be 2014, but it has to be the existing baseline of last year. So these are the main concerns that we have with RCEP. Now, if others are willing to accommodate that, then of course India can try and look at that in a fresh light. But since it seemed a little difficult at the moment to me, I thought we should take up from where we left off with Australia, and when we started RCEP negotiations, because we thought that the RCEP would overtake in any case what we were negotiating with Australia. The reason why I advocate reopening those negotiations with Australia, it's quite simple, because our exports, for example, I'll give you two or three examples. Textiles and gems and jewelry, for instance, or even automobile components or tires, they all attract more duty than the other countries who, with whom Australia has a free trade agreement. And Australia has a free trade agreement with most of the countries in ASEAN, and of course they have an agreement with China and Japan, etc. So obviously these countries are at an advantage. The second issue is about investments, where people look at global value chains and supply chains which can complement each other. So somebody who's investing in Southeast Asia or Australia will find it better to be there rather than be in India, because they don't have that market with an access at a lower tariff. So of course India is a big market, but people always think of a much, much larger, on a much, much larger scale. And that will also help us, I believe, because then it will allow our companies to invest in Australia, also use other markets at a much cheaper tariff to export from there, if that is a possibility. For example, this is something that we've recommended in agribusiness, and also in terms of renewable energy components, where our companies are doing well. They're also exporting railway wagons and railway stock, for instance, to Australia now, which is a new thing. So all these require a level playing field, which we don't have in Australia at the moment. And obviously, our exports and investments will both gain with that. Australia will also gain. But the fact is that Australians are 25 million people. And how much can they swamp India? I mean, one has to look at it in perspective as well. So we have our own strength. If we have some concerns, I think those concerns can be flagged in the negotiations. Some of those exceptions can be made in the product.
Thank you, gentlemen. That was a very enlightening and enriching discussion. You have given a very pragmatic dimension to the whole issue of the Australia-India bilateral relationship. I am sure your views will be taken seriously and they will be incorporated in the future policy decisions that the two countries will take. I thank you for joining in this discussion following the initial comments by the High Commissioners of our two countries. Thank you and Namaskar.